At the gate, thinking I don't deserve to pass through after all the mistakes that I've made. Oh, but I heard a whisper as heaven bent down, said, child, don't you know that the first will be last and the last get a crown? There's a seat at the table, it's waiting for you, so come on inside.
Try that again. Good morning. What a beautiful summer morning. I mean, we say that every week, but we keep dialing it in. Thank you, Lord. I mean, very little humidity this morning, beautiful temperature. Come on, farmers, you got to be a little excited. You could not get a better week for tasseling, right? Amen. We're going to start over here a moment. Come on, farmers. There you go. Well, good morning, Woodstock Church. It is great to be in the house of the Lord this morning out in the open air. Amen. And we get to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And it should be an all-out celebration today. Not just because we get to gather together, but we get to hear the word of the Lord. We get to worship the most incredible God. And we also get to partake of communion together as family and friends today. Are you excited about that? Now, there is one thing I'm not extremely excited about this morning, but we're going to announce it anyway, and that is the fact that it is my daughter's birthday, and I'm excited she has a birthday. I'm not excited about the number, but Adeline turns 14 today, and I am not that old, so amen. Happy birthday, Adeline. Happy birthday. And I have a number of announcements, but first, as we begin going through the plethora of them, I'm going to ask Joseph and Alyssa, or one of them, whoever's decided they're going to speak this morning, to come up front. And you can grab Kim's microphone. By way of a few things, housekeeping this morning, we're supposed to be celebrating this morning the welcoming into full membership of Val Kuntz and Sylvia Kuntz. But however, if you saw on Facebook this morning, Kane has the coronavirus, and so he's feeling fine, but out of being just wise, we've decided this morning we are going to just hold off for another couple weeks. And then just a reminder to fifth graders, junior high, and senior high schoolers, tonight, 6 o'clock, pool party in Edgerton. And so that should be a lot of fun, right? A reminder, we are doing some upgrades on our prayer chain. And so if you have not received any prayer chain updates this week and however need them, please see me after service. I don't think Kathy's here this morning. So just find me or Kim, and we'll make sure that you get on that list. Also, just a reminder, kids, you're still welcome to join us for summer breakout on Wednesday nights. We are having a blast. just playing and celebrating the goodness of God. And there are t-shirts for sale in the building if you want to sign up for them at the Welcome Center. We would largely encourage that. And now, Joseph and Alyssa, you guys, why'd you go down there? That's no fun. I could pat you on the head now. They have a few things they want to share with us this morning. Good morning, New Life. Good morning. Good to see you guys. All right, go.
So, most of you know, is this on?
Yep.
Okay, perfect. Most of you know we've been in the adoption process. And about 6 months ago, we were in contact with a young lady that was pregnant, that was looking at adoption. And so anyway, it's been a long journey these 6 months, but it looks like the adoption will go through. She's due on the end of July. Woo! So it's coming really fast. Anyway, it's been a really, it's not been an easy 6 months at all for me or for Alyssa. But God has shown himself very faithful and very, very gentle and compassionate. So thank you all for your prayers, for your caring. We would ask that you join us in praising God for this and thanking him for what he's done. And please continue to pray for us and pray for that little baby. And pray for the birth parents too, because they're going to have a hard time with this, I think, especially the mom. So we're really excited, and we thank you for your support.
Don't go anywhere. Oh, don't go anywhere. This is real professional, don't you think? I'd like you all to stand, would you please? And you guys all know what's coming, but if you've been a part or watched family or friends go through the adoption process, the roller coaster of emotions from sometimes minute to minute is quite something, isn't it? And I've gotten a front row seat to see the very high highs and the really low lows. And it was such a miracle that I know that they're not talking about yet, because they want it all take place, not just with this adoption, but literally the miracle that took place in the transition from one adoption agency to how God has orchestrated this. And so stay tuned, because there's quite a story that's coming. But they need our prayers big time, because it's not done yet, but we believe in faith that it is. And so if you would extend a hand, we're going to pray for Joseph and Alyssa this morning, and we're going to come in unity surrounding Joseph and Alyssa. Lord God, we thank you, Lord God, that you make a way where there seems to be no way. Amen? And Lord God, that you have made level Joseph and Alyssa's path. Lord God, that you knew this child before it was formed in its mother's womb. And Lord God, that you have selected this child, we believe in faith, to be raised by this couple. Lord God, for Joseph and Alyssa to be able to be the mom and dad that you've created them to be. Lord God, to raise a child in the way that it should go, that it is as grows older, Lord, that will not depart from your way. And we want to praise you in advance for the work that you're doing and how you are making this take place. Lord God, we want to pray right now for the birth parents. Lord God, the courageous decision that they have made, Lord God, on this child's behalf. Lord God, we believe that this is directed of you. And so, God, we ask that nothing, absolutely nothing, would stand in the way. Lord God, we ask that you would send angel armies to protect Joseph and Alyssa, to protect that baby, to protect the birth parents. And Lord God, we ask that, Lord, this would be such a celebration on earth as it is in heaven. Lord God, we celebrate already the work that is taking place. Lord God, we celebrate, Lord, the life that is going to take place shortly. And Lord God, we thank you for it. And so, Lord God, give Joseph and Alyssa the courage, the comfort, and strength, and the support that they need in every way, shape, or form through this journey. In Jesus' name we pray. And a faith-filled church said, amen. We love you guys. We love you guys. Give them a hand this morning. You can be seated. And then just another, so Kaya, I'm going to get real for a moment. Not that I'm never real, but the bottom line in this, yeah, I love the hugs that are taking place. It, well worth it. Amen. How many of you throughout the weeks with the whole coronavirus and all the junk that's going on have had moments of discouragement? Anybody want to raise their hand? Hello. I mean, it is, even yesterday, I'm just fighting it. I'm constantly going, in the name of Jesus, get off me. I don't want this junk on me. And how the enemy plays games in the midst of that. And I think it's moments like this where we get to celebrate the testimony that God is still at work, church. He didn't fall asleep. He didn't wash his hands of us. We are still children of promise. And he is still a miracle-working God. He is making a way where there seems to be no way. And that is the God who, that's who he is. That's who we worship. That's why we've gathered here this morning to worship a living God. And we as a church for, well, man, what, a year and a half, if not more, have been praying for Pastor Carl and Kathy. And there was a moment in January that looked like there was a donor and it was going to happen, and then for whatever reason, it fell apart. And then the wrestling that takes place of when, God, we trust you even though we don't understand. And so Kathy and Carl have asked me to make this announcement as well this morning. But they have found a live donor for Pastor Carl. And so, which we need to also be bathing that in a lot of prayer right now. And we just celebrate with you. And we also know that you're on a roller coaster ride as you're waiting. And so that is scheduled for sometime late September. But I would ask you, church, to be praying and fasting for this, just like you would for Joseph and Alyssa and anybody else, that nothing stands in the way of this happening, that a coronavirus isn't able to shut down elective surgeries. This is, believe it or not, still considered an elective surgery. And so we need to pray that that takes place also in September. And then Carl's also having a quick surgery tomorrow in order to take out that port from dialysis, correct? And the at-home dialysis is going well, very, very well. And so lots of things to celebrate, amen? Also, Ken being here this morning, another miracle. Ken, we're glad that you are here. Karen, after having major surgery here a week and a half ago, here this morning. And so we serve a great God, right? And even though the enemy might want to stir and might want to bring discouragement and dissension and whatever else he wants to try to stir, when we stand united and, more importantly, when we stand in faith, he is immovable. And we are immovable when we're on that rock. Amen? Finally, it's just so good to see the Landings this morning. And so we miss you guys. It's fun to have you back on loan for the day. And so, Kyle, if you just want to jump up there and feel at home, go for it. But we're excited about what God's doing in your life over in South Dakota. Yeah, uh-huh. See, there's no social distancing in this row. So, hey, church family, let's pray together as we open our service. And let's posture our hearts. Lord God, we love you. Lord God, with no better way to start out a service than confessing our love for you. And Lord God, our desperate need of you. Lord, there are so many things today that we need to stand in pause and just celebrate. Lord God, we are really good at petitioning the throne when we need something. But Lord God, I know that in my own life, I am not good at coming before the throne and coming before you on bended knee, Lord God, and just praising you for the miracles that take place every day. Lord God, this morning we highlight and we celebrate, Lord God, just the beauty in which we get to sit in today. Lord God, we couldn't ask for a more beautiful summer day. Lord God, we praise you for the timely rains that you have sent us. Lord God, we thank you for how crops look. We thank you, Lord God, for what a beautiful week it will be for tasseling and for haying. And Lord God, we just want to thank you that in the shifting of the seasons, you are ever faithful. Lord God, when we see the sun rise each morning and we see it set in the evening, Lord God, we are reminded that you are on your throne, that, Lord God, not a hair from our head falls without you knowing about it. And Lord God, we thank you that that is who you are. Lord God, we want to praise you this morning for the miracle that's taking place in the life of Joseph and Alyssa and that little baby. Lord God, we cannot wait as a church to celebrate around what you are doing there. Lord God, we thank you for life and the gift of life. Lord God, we thank you not only for that, but Lord, we thank you for the gift of life and the expecting moms in our church family right now. Lord God, we thank you that the gift of life is a reminder of your miracles at work in and amongst us. Lord God, we want to thank you for the miracle of life and providing Pastor Carl a living donor. Lord God, and we just look forward to those days in September where that kidney gets to be donated and, Lord God, life gets to be transferred once again and life abundantly for Carl and for this donor. And, well, Lord, we want to thank you for medicine. We want to thank you for how you use it. And we just pray already in advance for the doctors and for the nurses. Well, God, we want to thank you also this morning for the medical field and Lord, your miraculous work in the life of Ken over the last 2 days and his ability to be able to come home. And we ask, Lord God, that you would put his blood pressure back in check. Lord God, that you would bring peace and comfort around him as he awaits to meet with the cardiologist. Lord God, we thank you for the work and the healing that's taking place in Karen's body. And Lord God, we thank you that she is doing so incredibly well. Lord, we thank you for the miracle that you've done in Greg's life. And Lord, the physical therapy that he's undergoing. And Lord God, how he is literally weeks ahead of schedule after that huge open heart surgery. Lord God, we thank you for the healing taking place in Debbie's life after her surgeries this spring. Lord, we ask for strength over their family. Lord, we pray this morning for Emma Jasper. Lord God, as she is still down south in Texas and then this week finding out that her son-in-law has the coronavirus and Lord God, and he has been struggling with his health. We pray, Lord, this morning, a healing hand of mercy on him. Lord God, bring comfort to him in Jesus' name. Lord God, we pray for our family that are being affected by the coronavirus. Lord God, this morning we pray for Kane Booker. Lord God, we just pray for healing on him. Lord God, we also pray for those in our nursing homes. Lord God, we pray for Marie, Lord Dolores, and Lord God, for Ethel and Henrietta. Lord God, we pray, Lord, that you would be protecting them, Lord, in the midst of all of this. Lord God, be protecting our minds, that we would keep our minds focused on you. Lord God, that in the midst of fear, we would grab onto faith and hope and love. Lord God, this morning we confess we are in need of you, a mighty God and a mighty Savior. And Lord, as we partake of communion later in the service, would you be preparing our heart and our minds, Lord God, to receive all that you have for us. And so, Lord God, this morning we thank you that we get to come before you. And Lord God, that you have taught us as a church family how to pray in your word. And so this morning, together we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed. I would ask this morning that you would just stand as we prepare for worship. And as we prepare for worship, would you please, in a respectful yet socially distancing manner, just greet those around you. Just say good morning. Tell them you love them. So does Jesus. And welcome them here. Good morning, New Life.
Yeah. It's go time.
I think you were just shooting.
It's not the first time. Won't be the last.
That one.
Right. No, it's like Heart Attack Central right there.
Yeah.
It's just too young.
It is too young.
Kittens. Yeah. We're babysitting kittens.
Was that a... Do you want to start?
I think so.
Well, since we are all standing, why don't we worship this morning? So we are...
are going to start with My Feet Are on the Rock. And isn't it so amazing? As Brian's talking about, you know, kind of things change day to day and what we can do and what we can't do. And maybe sometimes you feel like you're being told what you can do. But the great thing is that our feet can continually be on that rock and we can just love who God is and trust him that he is in control. I can see the clouds roll in, and I can feel the winds, they try to shake me. I will not be moved, my feet are on the rock. And I can feel the waters rise, and I can hear the howling lies that haunt me. Fear won't hold me now, my feet are on the rock. And when I feel my hope about to break, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way. I'll be dancing in the rain. My feet are on the rock. And I can see the morning light, and I can feel the joy on the horizon. Here my faith is found. I stand on solid ground. When I feel my hope about to break, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way. I'll be dancing in the rain. My feet are on the rock. On Bryce's solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock. On Bryce's solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all the ground is sinking sand. So stop your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock. When I feel my hope about to break, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give away. I'll be dancing in the rain. When I feel my hope about to break, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give away. I'll be dancing in the rain. My feet are on the rock. My feet are on the rock. So we've sang this one before, Waymaker, and just as Joseph and Alyssa were talking and the great stuff with Kathy and the people who are out of the hospital healing well, isn't it amazing how our God makes a way when there seems to be none? And even when we do not see him working, we know that he is doing something.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you.
You are here.
You are here. Touching every heart, I worship you. I worship you. You are promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. Darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are a way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. And even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Father God, that is who you are. God, we ask that you would show us a way where there is no way. God, we know that you're always working. We know that you are constantly fighting for us. God, I ask that you would help us to realize it. God, that you are on our side. That doesn't mean that you're in our way. That doesn't mean that we get our way. But Father God, that you are fighting for us.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. Cheer up.
him a shout of praise this morning.
You may be seated. Can you say this morning with assurance that those words that you just sang are true in your life? Can you say that? And here's the deal. I understand that there are a good number of us that have this disease. All right, it's called Dutchness. And in that moment of Dutchness, if you will, I don't even think that's a proper term, but you don't have that, whatever. There's a small percentage of you that is Dutch, Melody Joy. She wants to deny it, though. But the bottom line is that there is this desire innately, if you're Dutch or not, where we don't often want to quickly come and ask for the things that we need. Anybody guilty of that? You know, I'll pull myself up by my bootstraps and I've got it. And you know what, God, I'll just come to you for the big stuff. But I want to tell you that God wants to be in the details of your life too. Amen? He wants to be there. And so if you are struggling this morning, if you are in need of something, my prayer and hope for you is that you will cry out to him. That your pride will not stand in the way of the blessings in which God wants to manifest in your life. The biggest deterrent from us receiving the blessings that God has for us is sitting in your chair. It's you, by the way. Why? Because we are so many times we don't want to ask or receive the things that God truly wants to pour into our lap. And when we have been looking and examining the life of Jonah, we've been going on a journey with Jonah, if you will, and learning from his mistakes, hallelujah. Which one of us can't find ourselves in the story of Jonah? I mean, that story that we're looking at, this true real life account, I hope that you can see your picture in some of what's taking place here. We all have Jonah moments. You know what? And instead of answering the call in which God had for him, Jonah decided that he was going to run the opposite direction. Instead of going 500 miles to Nineveh to do what God asked, he decided to go the long way around to Tarshish, 2,500 miles. Can I tell you, if there's not a lesson in that, the lesson, if you're a little slow like I am sometimes, the bottom line is when you do it your way, it's going to take four times longer. It's true. It's kind of like the guy, praise God for GPS, amen? I mean, how many marriages have not been spared because of GPS? But I still, when Melody and I first got married, GPS was not something that we could afford at that point in time. And so, you know what? She would print out the instructions or I'd have to read a map and, oh boy, that didn't go very well. At all, hallelujah. But the thing is that, you know, how many of us get lost in the way because we don't want to go according to the roadmap? Jonah didn't want to go God's way. Jonah wanted to go his own way. And you know what? His rebellion got in the way. Maybe this morning you can relate with Jonah's story where God's asked you to do something and you've decided that you want to tuck tail and run the opposite direction. And the funny thing about it is that Jonah, a prophet of God who heard God's voice, who knew God's voice very well, thought somewhere in his pride and ignorance and maybe just a slight bit of arrogance, thought he could flee from God and really get by with it. And we find it humorous, maybe a little, but how many of us haven't tried that ourselves? Amen? Oh man, Lord, we're going to need some help this morning. So Jesus, we just ask that you would speak to us through your word. Lord God, we are in need of a touch from you today. Lord God, we're in need of encouragement and hope as the days continue to grow darker. Lord God, we know that we are called to shine even brighter. And Lord God, in those moments where you have called us to greatness, sometimes it's overwhelming. Sometimes we would just much rather stay in bed and have sheets pulled over our head and just pray for those moments in which it would just pass us by. And yet, Lord God, we know that we are not to sit idly by. Lord God, we ask that this morning that you would bring conviction where conviction needs to be. Lord God, that you would suspend warfare on our behalf as we hear the word. Lord God, we pray against distraction. Lord God, may your word not return void in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, and a faith-filled church said, amen. If you would turn with me to the book of Jonah, I promise it is the train is slow getting out of the station, but we will get there. Amen? You know it eventually comes to a resolve, but there are a few things that continue to stir that I want to continue to capitalize on and hit on as we continue to move forward, and especially in light of communion today. I'm going to just start in Jonah chapter 1, and I'm going to read through some of the stuff that we've already covered just by way of review. In Jonah chapter 1, the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai. Go. Underline that in your Bible, would you please? If you have your, how many, well, I'm not going to ask for a show of hands. Please bring your Bible to church. All right, listen, this is the living word of God, and we need to be sharper in it than ever before. We need to know it like never before. And the beautiful thing is that you don't need to bring a 50-pound Bible like we used to all carry around. Now, some of you are holier, and you do that yet. That's okay. I'm not going to judge you. But the bottom line is that they can be found on your phones. But I had somebody, actually a good friend of ours, just bring this to my attention the other day. He's like, why on earth would you not bring your Bible to church? Now, this is not, some of you are going, I'm going to leave now. He's calling me out. Just, I'm not looking. But how many of you would go on a fishing trip and not bring a fishing pole? Now, Dan, don't raise your hand. There's a little bit of a story here. I went fishing with him a few weeks ago, and I didn't bring a fishing pole. In my defense, you told me not to. All right. So, bring your, you can't catch nothing if you don't bring a fishing pole, so bring your pole with you to church. Amen? Okay, I'm sorry. Underline the word in there because it's going to come important here. And so he said, go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it because of its wickedness that has come up before me. By the way, as I reflected on that whole wickedness scenario, if you will, it really, am I popping? Oh, isn't that fun? I'm on fire, that's why. I don't know what I can do for you, Val. I'm sorry. You want me to have a handheld? I guess I can go that direction. Should I switch pockets? All right, I'll switch pockets. Then I'm closer to you. There we go. All right, everybody give our sound team a hand. These guys are rock stars. All right, we'll try that. Maybe it's the wrong pocket. And so where was I? That wickedness. You know what? We see that same phrase when we find out that God's going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. Isn't that interesting? I think that's interesting. Anyway, the wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah, can you hear me? Can you turn me up a little? All right, I can yell louder, maybe. All right, and so the wickedness has come up before me. Verse 3, but Jonah, oh, you guys all know about my fetish with the word but, B-U-T. Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. And went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for the port. After paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. Now, this is what I had not caught in the last several weeks, so get ready for this. In verse, now, the NIV says it a little bit differently, but I found this in the New Living Translation. I also found it in the Message, and I believe it was in the King James. There are three translations this week. And verse 4 says this, but the Lord sent a great wind. I love how we find in verse 3, it's but Jonah, and then God answers back. Can I just tell you, when you're running the wrong direction, God's going to answer back. Hallelujah. Why is God going to answer back? Because he loves you. Aren't you glad that he loves you and that he is in fearless pursuit of you? Let me tell you something that Jonah has to find out much later on in this story. The fact is he can't hide from God. No matter how far he runs, no matter whether he's down in the hole of a ship or he's in the bottom of a belly of a great fish, he can't run from God. He's there, and the hounds of heaven are after him. Guess what? The hounds of heaven, church, are after you because of his great love for you. Somebody shout amen. He loves you, and he has sent a rescuer for you. He has sent you a way out of the mess you have found yourself in. He has sent us the most incredible gift of rescue that we could ever have asked for in his son, Jesus Christ. Amen? And he is in pursuit of you. The answer, the question is, are you willing to stop, turn, and receive the pursuit? Are you ready to sit still for just a minute and let Him just come over you, wave upon wave upon wave? The Lord sent a great wind on the sea. Last week we talked about the three different types of storms that I believe that we find in Scripture. And just by way of quick reminder, that the three that we talked about is that of the storms that are created when we have sin in our lives. The second is when the enemy creates a storm in our life because we're in pursuit of the Lord and He doesn't like it. And the third part is when God brings a storm in our life. And a reminder that the storms that God brings are not destructive to you, but are instructive to you. Amen? To build you up, to encourage you, but also in moments to discipline and get you on a different path. That's how good our God is. He doesn't leave us to our own merits if we turn. And then the Lord sent a great wind, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up, and all the sailors were afraid, and each cried to his own God. Now we're going to get into the point today where these sailors are crying out. Notice that they do two things here. Here you have a group of sailors. One of the commentaries by the name of Albert Barnes that I've been studying said this, that he found an ancient rabbi by the name of Jacob, that was a rabbi in early days of France, and he wrote an incredibly long commentary on the book of Jonah. And in his research, according to rabbinical Jewish tradition, when this is taught, it is taught that there were over 70 sailors from 70 different nations on this boat. I want you to think about that for a moment. 70 sailors from 70 different nations serving, mind you, 70 different gods. They realize that this storm is not of natural making. These are professional sailors. This is not your typical storm. How many of you might find yourself today in the midst of a storm that you're going, hey, wait a minute, this is not like any storm I've ever been in before. Hello, are we all walking through COVID together? Are any of you sick of being rocked by this ship? Are any of you about ready to vomit your guts out because you're so sick and tired of it? What is God trying to communicate to us in the midst of this storm? I actually had some, but I'm going to pause on this. I had somebody ask me this week, and I thought it was really insightful. I won't call them out. They're not here today anyway, so I should limit it. But they asked, what storm are we, you talked about three different storms. What would you categorize, Pastor Brian, as this COVID? Is this a storm for our sin? Is this a storm of the enemy? Or is this a storm of the Lord? That's exactly what my answer was. Yes to all three. We're in the midst of one whale of a storm, pun intended. That's supposed to be funny. Whale intended. Yeah, okay, never. One whale of a storm. Let's start that. I know you're a little slow this morning. My mic's not working, right? And here we are in one crazy storm. And I tell you what, even yesterday, like I shared earlier, riding that wave, and I know that there are frustrations all around. I know that there are many that like to be in that building, and I know there are many that want to be on the parking lot, but it's too hot, and many that want to stay in their cars, and you know what? It's really hard to keep everybody happy. I feel like a cat sometimes. It's okay. Here, kitty, kitty. Anyway, that's what... You really relatively make my job fairly easy. Let's keep it that way. But the bottom line is it gets to you after a while. And then there were immense amount of people in our congregation even this week that were tested for the coronavirus. And yeah, we are reaching out to families in the community. We have a ton of interaction week in and week out. And it's amazing how the enemy just starts playing games with you. There are many of you that were in hospitals this week. I can't go visit you. I don't like that. I want to come see you. I want to come visit with you. All right, this is not about Brian. Where was I even going with? Oh, the storm. What kind of storm are we in? The thing is that it's not so much about the storm or the cause of the storm, but what are we going to do in the midst of the storm? These sailors in the midst of the storm knew that there was something bigger than themselves that was taking place here. And even though they were pretty good heathen pagans and didn't believe in the one true God, they at least believe in a form of God. And so the first thing that Scripture tells us that they do is they prayed. Is that our first reaction in the midst of storm? Are we a praying people in the midst of this storm? Or do we do what they did second? They're praying while they're chucking stuff overboard. What can I do in order to do this in my own strength and my own power and my own might? Yeah, let's get rid of that. And the reason one of the commentators, Matthew Henry, wrote on this a little bit, that they thought that maybe the reason for the storm was the fact that somebody had the wrong type of idol, or somebody had something that was tainted on the ship. We got to get that crap overboard. Yes, I just said that word. I'm sorry. They're on to something. How many of us have stuff in our life that needs to be jettisoned? How many of us have things in our lives that need to be thrown overboard that are weighing us down in the midst of the storm? I tell you what, storms are a great opportunity for cleansing and purging and getting rid of those things that are weighing us down so that we can be quick to move. That when God tells us that we need to go on to the next season or to the next thing, that we're able to move quickly and freely because we don't have the baggage of this world weighing us down. What those sailors quickly realized is that no matter the amount of prayer, it wasn't working. No matter the amount of emptying out the cargo on the ship, it wasn't working. They needed to do something else. And this is where we find out, but Jonah had gone below deck, where he lay down and fell into a deep sleep. Oh, I want to just go on that for a minute, but we'll just keep going. The captain went to him and said, "How can you be sleeping?" That's a valid question. "Get up and call on your God. Maybe he will take notice of us so that we will not perish." I love this captain. Because the rebuke that he gave Jonah is what we talked about a little bit last week, of a rebuke that I believe we as a church need to be involved in, and the fact that we need to wake up. And this captain still had a sliver of hope that they could be saved. And he finds Jonah in the hold of the ship and says, "Hey, there still might be hope. Wake up. Pray to your God." Jonah had been blissfully unaware of what had been happening around him. In fact, I believe that Jonah, and I'm backing this up with a few other commentaries that I've read, John Allen being one of them, that said they believed that Jonah, after he had received the word of the Lord to go, that Jonah had been so frantic to try to get out of that situation that he probably had not slept in close to a week. He was exhausted. Can I tell you, when you're running from sin, when you're running from God, it's exhausting. Jonah didn't want to fall asleep because he figured God would awaken him in a dream. He didn't want to encounter God that way. He wanted to get out of Dodge about as quick as he could. And so by the time he hits that ship and he gets into the bottom of it, he falls into a deep sleep. Not only that, I believe it was a spiritual sleep of kind of numbing out. How many of us are in spiritual sleep right now and we need to be jarred awake? How many of us need a call from God to go, "Hey, wait a second. You can't stick your head in the sand any longer. You can't hide out in the ship. You can't pull the covers over your head and hope that this thing is going to go away." I don't know about you. I'm guilty of this. I'm just waiting the calendar out. I couldn't wait for summer because our numbers were going to get lower. We're going to be back in the building. We'll get back to a semi-way of normal. I hope somebody rebukes me after service for thinking so stupid. The thing is we don't know what tomorrow looks like. Hallelujah. Praise God, he's already there. Amen. But the bottom line is that I can't stay in bed hoping that this whole thing's going away, and neither can you. We as a people of God need to face the storm in which we're in, and we need to bring hope where there seems to be no hope. And the problem is that it's the captain, who has no idea who this God is, that actually jerks the slack out of Jonah. Think about how much this was a hit to Jonah's pride. The very fact that he is a prophet that is supposed to be bringing hope, it's supposed to be encouraging people to repentance and to prayer, and it's a captain that awakens him and says, "Get up and pray." I think that's funny. It is this captain that calls him to a place of faith. Church, I want to say right now, we might be very frustrated in the news that we hear and the things that we see and the dangers that are flaring up all around it. But can I just say, read between the lines. In counseling, we always look at the emotion, the reason for the emotion, and what's underlying it. The reason we do that is because very seldom what's on the surface is reality. It's what's below. Can I just tell you, what is the world trying to shout at us? What is below the surface that we need to wake up to? Nobody wants to say amen to that, so we'll just keep going. Jonah had gone below deck and he was sleeping. Captain called him to get up. There was hope of them being saved yet. However, the sailors on deck, by the time Jonah gets to the topside, they've already figured that this storm hasn't let up. They've jettisoned all their cargo. They've gotten rid of what they could get rid of. And now they decide amongst themselves what the Bible says here in verse 7, I believe it is. Now the sailors said to each other, "Come, let us cast lots to find out who is responsible for this calamity." And they cast lots. And now listen, this is not an uncommon Middle Eastern practice. In fact, we see this in Scripture in several different times where lots are cast. But the bottom line is that God uses this tool as a way to call Jonah out. They cast lots to figure out what it is. Guess what? The lot that is cast is upon Jonah. And then now, yeah, at any point, Jonah could have confessed, "The reason for the storm is me." But no, the coward, excuse me, forgive me, Lord, but the coward sitting there not confessing the fact that I might have some personal responsibility in this. Church, for the sin and the struggle that we find ourselves in, I hope that we're able to all admit that we have personal responsibility in this. And the only way we're going to get out of this mess is by the preaching of the gospel and confessing of sins and turning our eyes to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, seeing the gospel message of hope that is here for the world, not just for a few, but for all. That life-saving message. That's the only way out. I don't care how many racial reconciliations we have and it needs to take place in some forms. I completely understand that. But the only way out of this mess is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And here Jonah had the moment where he could have stepped up to the plate going, "You know what? I tried this and I truly screwed up. I'm really sorry, guys. This is my fault. You know what? Give me a moment. I'm going to get it right before God." But no, he doesn't do that. And now finally God has to call him out. Can I tell you, what is held in secret will be shouted from the rooftops, the New Testament tells us. Oh man, Jonah's secret sin is being shouted from the rooftop. He is being outed in front of all these guys. And finally they go, "What have you done? What have you done?" I love this. "Tell us who's responsible for making this trouble for us. What kind of work do you do?" Oh man, it's not just what have you done. It's what kind of work are you in? Where do you come from? What is your country? From what people are you? Oh man, can you just imagine how hard he had to swallow? "Well, really, I'm a prophet of God's word and I'm a prophet." And how many of us have had those moments where somebody starts asking us questions and we have to swallow deep and go, "Well, I'm a Christian. I'm a Christian." When our lifestyle is absolutely contrary to what we say we believe. Oh, now conviction's hitting. I better keep moving. But isn't that true? Or maybe it's just me. Have those moments where we're just like, "Oh, yeah, well, you know, tell me about yourself. Where do you go to church?" "Well, yeah, I'm a Christian." "Oh, you're a Christian? Really? This is the Jonah moment. What's your job?" "Well, I'm a prophet." And he starts lining out this whole thing of who he is. They figured that he had to have done something horribly terrible. There had to have been a murderer on board. There had to have been somebody that had committed adultery. There had to have been a whole long list of sins. And I believe Jonah felt justified in this. This storm can't be because of me. Somebody else is way worse than I am. How many times have we justified our sins that way? "Well, you know what? I sinned a little bit over here, but somebody else is far worse than I am." This storm can't be a result of my sin, but the reality of it is that it is. Jonah was running. He was in rebellion, and he had to finally answer, "I'm a Hebrew, and I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." And this terrified them. Why did it terrify them? Because this is Almighty God they're talking about. This is no little image. This is no little idol. This is not something that they could carry with them. You are claiming that the God you serve, the God that you're is the creator of heaven and of earth. And they knew that he was telling the truth. What have you done? They had already known that he was running away from the Lord because Jonah had already told them and the sea was getting rougher. So they asked him, what must we do in order to make this sea calm down? And I love this. Jonah says, well, pick me up and throw me over sea. And it will be calm. I know, and this is finally, and you could, this is Brian's take on it, but almost through clenched teeth. I know that it's my fault. I mean, finally, after all this, he confesses. Instead, the men are so convicted. I want you to think about this for a moment. They are so convicted, and Jonah says, this is what you have to do in order to calm the sea. But instead, in verse 13, instead the men did their best to row back to land. But they could not. Why are they rowing back to land? Why are they trying here? Because they don't want to be guilty of murder. That's how convicted they are. They don't want to be convicted of murdering this man, and so they are going to try in their own works to row back to shore to bring this man back to the place of his calling, to the place of his wrongdoing. Maybe God will give favor if we just row back to shore, but it's too late for that. I'm going to skip ahead from the rest of my notes. Everybody can say hallelujah to that. They finally throw him overboard. You guys have been waiting for this point. They finally throw him overboard. Jonah couldn't swim. Jonah's going down. And he's sinking fast. The remarkable thing, and I think we'll touch on it next week, is that the moment that they threw Jonah into the sea, it became instantly calm. Not just over time. If there's a big raging sea or a raging storm, it usually takes 24 hours for the water to become calm. The miraculousness of this storm that the Bible says immediately it became calm. That just doesn't happen without God's power. Immediately the sea became calm, and Jonah is sinking, sinking, sinking. The sailors never knew that he got rescued. But in verse 17, now the Lord provided a huge fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and for 3 nights. What I want to focus on as we prepare our hearts for communion, what was going through Jonah's mind as he's sinking to his death? He thinks it's over. I wonder in the back of his mind if he thought, you know what, maybe it would have been better had I gone on to Nineveh instead of tried to run for it. You know what, the incredibleness of the book of Jonah is that the entire gospel message is laid out. And as we prepare our hearts for communion, how many of us have had sin that's caused us to run from God? You know, the very definition of sin is that, worship team, you can come forward. The very definition of sin is that it separates us from God. Jonah was trying to distance himself as far from God as he could. Maybe that's you this morning. But can I just remind you as I opened the service earlier that God is in pursuit of you. God is in pursuit of you, of his deep love for you. He has a call and a plan and a purpose for your life. He is patient, Paul says, in a way that none, so that none may perish. That's his desire. He is graciously patient with us and gives us an entire lifetime in order to come right with him. I tell you that sin separates us, and sin causes us to go down, 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 just like Jonah went down to Joppa, just like Jonah went down to the hull of the ship, just like Jonah's going down to the bottom of the sea. Can I just tell you, sin and the weight of it will take you down. But you want to know the good news? He sends a rescuer. He sends a rescuer. For Jonah, that rescuer in this moment is that of a big fish. But can I tell you, that's a foreshadowing of the rescuer that Jesus will be for you and for me if we allow him in. God sent his only son in the midst of our separation. The only way that he could bring reunification between us and God was that he would lay his life down, that he would rescue us, and that Jesus would have to lay his life down and spend 3 nights and 3 days in the face of, in the belly of the earth. But the most important part is that God raised him from the dead, that he would be our Savior, our intercessor, our rescuer, our Redeemer. Is that not the best news ever? And we find that in the book of Jonah. I would ask this morning that you would grab your communion cup. If you're listening online, we would encourage you to join us for communion. Quick run to your fridge and grab a little juice and a piece of bread or whatever you can find and join us as we take communion together. If you did not receive this morning, would you just raise your hand and we'll make sure that one of our elders quick bring to you? As we prepare to take this morning, a reminder that we here at Woodstock as a family, we have over across the street, Earl, we celebrate what's called open communion. And that means that if you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and you are living for Him to the best of your ability and you are serving Him, we invite you to partake with us today. And so across the street, Earl, Bryce, I don't think Earl heard me. Can you? All right, anybody else? Let's pray as we prepare our hearts this morning. Lord God, we thank you for what we hold in our hand. Lord God, for what we hold in our hand is a reminder of what you have done for us. Lord God, a reminder of the price that you paid. And Lord God, what gives us such powerful perspective is that of reflection. Lord God, give us a proper perspective in you this morning of who we are in you. Church family, if you've not taken communion this way before with us, there's a little film on the top of it, and you can pull that off, and in there is a wafer. Church family, I'd ask that you grab that in your hand this morning, and what that wafer represents is the body of Jesus Christ. On the night in which Jesus was to be betrayed, he gathered his closest friends and family in the upper room to take of the Passover, which later now we translate into the Lord's Supper. And what he did was took a loaf of bread and passed it around and asked his disciples to take and to break off a piece of that bread. And as they did so, he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you." Aren't you glad, church, as you hold that representation of the body in your hand this morning, that he took the punishment of sin and death upon him, that he took the scourge of our sin, the cost and the price on his physical body for you? What you hold in your hand this morning is a representation of that body. Church family, I would encourage you this morning to take and eat. As you take and eat, my prayer is that you will taste and see that God is good. Amen. Then if you take off the second layer, you expose the cup. Reminder that this morning is grape juice, but it is a reminder of the blood in a new covenant, a new beginning in which is marked out for us in Jesus Christ. A new covenant and a new beginning in which we, believers in Jesus Christ, have accepted him as our Lord and Savior, are washed clean of our sins. That he is faithful when we come and repent to wash us is new. That we are as white and spotless as freshly fallen snow. Church family, if you would take that cup this morning and that you would take it together as a reminder of the blood of Christ that has been spilt for you. Take. Church, I want to ask you something maybe a little but unorthodox. Did that taste good? Did that juice hit the spot this morning? There's a sweetness to it that can... That is a reminder of the sweetness that is found not only in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, but that is found in the sweetness of the Holy Spirit that has been imparted to us as the believer. I pray today that as you leave this place, that you are able to remember the sweetness of Jesus in your life. And as we prepare to leave and go forth to this place, I would ask that you would stand and that we would sing this closing song together as we remember the price that Jesus paid for us.
As you guys are standing, that reminds me, we did communion as a family when the kids were little, and the next day, Adeline asked if she could drink some juice, and so we said, sure, and she took a drink of it and said, oh, that's some good Jesus. So just remember that today, is that he is so good. Are you hurting and broken within, overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. And leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. And bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Lord Jesus, for that precious blood. And thank you for the hope that we have in you and in you alone. Lord God, I pray that as a church, as believers in Christ listening today online, Lord God, that we would be awakened to what you have called us to. Lord God, that we would no longer sleep nor slumber, but Lord God, be awakened to all that you have called our church and us as believers to be. God, may we have eyes fully open, both in the natural and in the supernatural, to see what you're doing, where you're going, and how we as a church can be a part of it. Lord God, call us to mission, to be on point for you. In Jesus' name we pray, and a faith-filled church said, amen. Church family, if you are in need of any prayer today, I'm going to ask that the elders, as we close out the service, would stand here in the front. If you are in need of coming to the altar and need prayer for someone in your life, if you're struggling with something, if you are just in need of encouragement, that there are those here that are willing and ready to pray for you. My hope is that you have an incredible week and that you feel the blessing of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Now go in power, fully awake to what he has in store for you, that you might not miss a cue from the heavenly throne room. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, have a great week. God bless you. There's fellowship off to the side after service.